Session on the eyes of Texas and the origins of the song are Professor H.W. Brands, who holds the Jack C. Blanton Chair in the History of the University of Texas at Austin. He writes about American history and politics. His most recent book is Our First Civil War: Patriots and Loyalists in the American Revolution. Professor Alberto Martinez is a full professor at UT History Department, where he has worked for 16 years. He's the author of 6 books, mainly on the history of science, including Science Secrets, The Truth About Darwin's Finches, Einstein's Wife, and Other Myths. He has been a research fellow at MIT, Harvard, Caltech, the Smithsonian, and Boston University. Dr. Dwonna Naomi Goldstone is associate professor of history and director of the African American Studies Program at Texas State University. She's the author of Integrating the 40 Acres, a 50-year struggle for racial equality at the University of Texas, which won the Coral H. Tooley's Memorial Prize for the best book on Texas history. Finally, Professor Ted Gordon is the founding former chair of the African and African Diaspora Studies Department, associate professor of African and African Diaspora Studies and Anthropology of the African Diaspora, and vice provost for diversity at the University of Texas at Austin. Dr. Gordon is also the former associate vice president of thematic initiatives and community engagement of the Division of Diversity and Community Engagement, as well as former director of the Center for African and African American Studies at the University of Texas. His teaching and research interests include culture and power in the African diaspora, gender studies, particularly Black males, critical race theory, race education, and the racial economy of his space and resources. His publications include that Disparate Diasporas, Identity and Politics in the African Nicaraguan Community, 1998, University of Texas Press. And I am Jorge Cañizares Guerra, the current director of the Institute of Historical Studies. Okay. So today we have these prominent scholars who have done research on the history of race at the University of Texas, and we have agreed to follow the following order. At the beginning, Professor Goldstone will have 5-7 minutes to introduce her knowledge of the song in the context of her own book. Then Professor Brands will follow and try to kind of contextualize the findings of the commission. And finally, Professor Martinez will share with us his own findings, his own independent research on the origins of the song. And then we'll open up for questions and conversation. Professor Gordon will have to leave at 12:30. So he'll be with us for the next 25 minutes. Okay, without further ado, I turn the mic to Professor Goldstone. Thank you.
Thank you very much for inviting me today, and I will keep my thoughts short. I will not speak for 5 to 7 minutes and look forward to the conversation afterwards. I must confess, though, that I was unaware of any racist undertones regarding the Eyes of Texas until Professor Gordon brought light to the issue a few years ago. Thank you for your work, Dr. Gordon, and for continuing to talk about this issue. As I did my research for my dissertation, which would become my book, I learned that many racist events took place as white fans sang the Eyes of Texas. From the Texas Cowboys minstrel shows to the all-white University of Texas football team winning a national championship, throngs of white fans sang the Eyes of Texas with much pride in their eyes. Though many Black and brown folks today join in the celebration, many of us have never felt like the song belonged to us or was even appropriate to sing. What still surprises me, though, is the adoration that white UT fans continue to hold about a song that is, if nothing else, problematic. in spite of what the committee said about the song last year, let me be frank, I don't agree with the conclusions they made. I will never understand why the ultimate decision wasn't to just create or adopt a new school song. The other thing I will never understand is why the new head coach, current head coach of the football team, said that all players would sing the song, including Black players who had earlier protested the song. While I do understand why he said that, he wanted to make sure that white boosters knew that he was on their side. In doing that, he told Black players that his loyalty was to white boosters and not to them. I probably should not say this, but I am glad to see that UT is a mediocre football team and hope they stay mediocre given how they see Black men as tools for winning games, but not as men who deserve a safe playing space and a safe learning environment away from a song that clearly has racism in its origins. Thank you.
Thank you. That was short and powerful. So now it's Professor Brand's turn. He was a member of the commission.
Yes. So thank you, Jorge. I appreciate Professor Goldstone's comments. I'd just like to make one slight correction, that it was not within the charge of the committee to render an opinion whether the song should be kept. We had been informed ahead of time that the Board of Regents and the university president had said the song is going to remain the song of the University of Texas. So our charge was to examine the history of the song. And we all knew this going in. So I'm going to lay out what I understand to be the agreed upon facts about the origins of the Eyes of Texas. And Al, of course, will have his opinions. Professor Martinez will have his opinions on this. But I think that most of what I say, I think he'll agree with this. So the first thing is that the song premiered at a minstrel show that was held in downtown Austin in May of 1903. And it is documentable that the minstrel show was like most minstrel shows in that a large part of the cast was in blackface. And the varsity quartet, the four men that sang The Eyes of Texas, they were blackfaced for this performance. So that part is clear enough, I think. And I don't think anybody disputes that at this point. And by the way, I would also like to thank Professor Gordon for just raising this issue to give me a chance. I had no idea about the origins of the Eyes of Texas. And so get a chance to examine this and find out what those facts were. A couple of other facts that are worth noting is that the Eyes of Texas has a tune that is the same tune of I've been working on the railroad, often called the Levee song. No one knows where that tune came from. There's a heart of the tune that was in part of a composition by Franz Suppé that came from the mid-19th century. But where he got it and its connection to the Levee song and then from that to the Eyes of Texas is unclear. It's also clear that the lyrics of the Eyes of Texas share nothing more than a single line of the lyrics of the Levee song, All the Live Long Day. Other than that, the words are original. Now, original in the sense that John Sinclair, the person who wrote the lyrics, wrote them himself. He took as his theme a phrase that was often repeated by the then president of the university, William Prather, who said to the students that he would address that the eyes of Texas are upon you. So that, I think, is what is agreed upon factually about this song. Now, there are things surrounding this, beyond this, that are subject to debate, subject to dispute, but I think we can agree on that part. And I would add that this is that before the committee met, there was still a lot of question as to, was this song indeed premiered at this event, this minstrel show? Were the performers in blackface? And I will tell you that I didn't know the answer to this. And honestly, when I went in, I thought it would be odd that a song like The Eyes of Texas would be performed in blackface, but in fact it was. So I've learned something there. So I'm going to stop there and invite Al to answer, to dispute what I've said so far, and then we'll continue the conversation and see. So I think the major part of the dispute, at least from what I've read of Al's writings, is what all this means, what these facts mean, and what meaning maybe went into them, what meaning was drawn out of them. So I'll stop there and listen to what Professor Martinez has to say.
Okay, thank you. Al, your turn.
Thank you, Bill, Dwonna, Ted, and Jorge for being here and for inviting me. I'm very glad to hear from all of you. My intervention in the song, the history of this song, was surprising, inadvertent to me. Like many people, I was just looking forward to the UTIS committee report on what they might find about the history of the song. And I had my own questions before the report came out. I had one key question, which was, to me, and this is not something that I had seen raised before, but to me what mattered was this song written to be performed in the minstrel show? So certainly if people that we don't like get together and sing Happy Birthday, I thought, you know, we shouldn't be upset. We shouldn't ban or censure that song because the song just happens to be used for that occasion. Now, when I read the committee's report, the answer to this seemed opaque or ambiguous to me. So I decided I'm gonna try to figure it out myself. That was one of the connections. Another one was, what was the connection to General Lee? And I'll say why. Before the UT committee was created, there were four outstanding recurring concerns that had been voiced by UT students about the song. One, is it connected to General Lee? They had heard that it was. Two, seems to be based on the racist Levy song, a song that includes the N-word twice. Three, does it have some connection to slavery? People thought, even athletes, many that, or some that, that the lyrics had strange connotations about surveillance. And fourth, what exactly was the connection to the minstrel show? Was that really the first performance? So in those four regards, I investigated at length to see what I could find. Going to my original concern, which was this song actually created for the minstrel show? I found that indeed that is what it was, according to the author and numerous other people, performers, audience members, friends of the author, family members of the author. The author, John Lang Sinclair, came to UT in 1914, and he was surprised to see that this song had become a community song of the university. And he gave an interview. He explained that last minute, his friend or fellow student, Lewis Johnson, desperately needed a song, one more thing for this minstrel show that they were putting together. And he liked the Levy song, so he based this new song on the Levy song. So that explanation given in 1914 is reiterated with various other details by John Lang Sinclair of letters from 1935, three letters from 1939, another letter of 1940, and by multiple other acquaintances and people close to him, and in no uncertain terms. So at one point, John Lang becomes upset that this fellow former student, Lewis Johnson, who had prodded him to write the song, has been telling a different story. He went around North Texas, meeting with different groups, giving a different alternate history of this event, which I simply call whitewashing. And John Lang wrote to the former head of the Texas Exes, the Alumni Association, his good friend and former registrar of UT, who was working at UT and well-known to John when he was a student there. He wrote 1939 Sinclair to Lomax. Anybody who knows anything about the original Eyes of Texas song knows that his first appearance was when sung at the minstrel show at the Hancock Opera House, just as it has survived. The Glee Club had the Levy song as one of its favorite numbers. It was only natural for me to make use of it for a little fun at Colonel Prather, university's president, on that occasion. There can be no reasonable explanation for such an outrage as the original hymn, that is a song, another version of the song, except that someone thought the minstrel performance was undignified and sought to improve it. He was interviewed at the Daily Texan about this. He was interviewed by the Austin American Statesman, and they wrote, Sinclair poo-pooed the idea that he had written The Eyes of Texas for a university, him. He said it was just dashed off for diversion. He said it came forth for a single purpose, which was aiding in an evening of entertainment. Similarly, in a letter to Professor L.W. Payne, it was written for a show at the Hancock Opera and only for that particular occasion. So then we put that in context of this other guy, sometimes called a co-author, sometimes called a collaborator, Lewis Johnson, who said multiple things throughout the decades about the origin of the song, that it was first performed in front of President Prather's home as a protest, that it was first performed at the UT Auditorium, that it was not performed at the Hancock Opera House, that it was not performed in spring of 1903, but in spring of nine, but in fall of 1904, I'm sorry, in fall in 1903, or et cetera. I mean, the guy gives contradiction after contradiction, that the song is about Texan virility and manliness. And there's a limit to how much one can stretch the credibility of an individual who not only contradicts all the evidence, even the evidence in newspapers, undeniable time capsule evidence from newspapers about when and where the song was performed. And throughout decades, he held on to what he called this cherished belief about the origin of the Eyes. So it's natural that just as to him, to many other white alumni, it is reassuring comforting to imagine and to think that this song was not a creation for a minstrel show. Even though the author said it was, it is based on a song that was used in minstrel shows, a song about Black workers who were convicts working in a prison labor camp, brutal long hours, even though it was performed in blackface. So contrary to this and other reasons, you know, I can go on and on. It's certainly reassuring. And why is that? I think it's because an important part of American culture is forgetting. Let sleeping dogs lie. Why don't you just let it go? Don't make a mountain out of a molehill. It doesn't mean that to me, therefore it shouldn't mean that to you. There's endless slogans that people use, thinking that they're actually thinking, and they're not thinking. They're just parroting memes that the culture gave them in order to tolerate things that are disturbing. So students had some concerns. The committee came out with its report. I found worse things than what the committee found and published. So I felt, you know, this has to be described. To me, the most surprising, disturbing aspect of the origin of the song was finding out that the seemingly weakest point in the students' concerns was correct. Seemingly weakest point, as even football athletes had said, they said, you know, I thought the song has some connection to slavery. And I thought, well, that point's obviously false. It's not a song about slavery, it's a song about workers. But when I looked into what those workers were, then I found that there was this brutal system of convict leasing that happened after the Civil War in states such as Texas, in which Black men were arrested for no reason, incarcerated, and then rented to farm owners, plantation owners, mine owners, and railroad construction firms, so that these men could be abused in a way far more brutal than they ever have been in slavery, because now instead of owning the slave, you rented the slave. So when this was finally exposed, trailblazing reporter who lived in Austin and worked for the San Antonio Express, reporter George Waverly Briggs, it was so unbelievable that people said, let's create a commission to investigate whether this is correct. And the people in Texas were worried, well, what if the committee whitewashes the abuses that are happening? Surprisingly, the commission did not. And they found the diseased, filthy, stinking, starved, bloody conditions in which these men were kept with leather straps. They were beaten with bull whips. So to me, it was certainly eye-opening. I had no idea that this song, I've Been Working on the Railroad, is a song about that. That's just what the song is about. And when one puts it in context, then it's fitting that when one then rereads the lyrics of The Eyes of Texas, all the livelong day, the eyes of Texas are upon you, you cannot get away, do not think you can escape them, at night or early in the morn, it feels like a song about inescapable statewide surveillance. So naturally, when I looked for the meaning of the song, that is not what it meant to me, but what it meant to people at different decades, I found that indeed, early in the 20th century, when the song came out, to people such as one of the first quartet singers, Jim Cannon, this song was about the omniscience of surveillance. And there was this joke about the UT president used to say, the eyes of Texas are upon you. There were cartoons about this kind of statewide surveillance. And most importantly to me, it turned out that when I found one of the accounts by one of the original performers at the minstrel show, Henry Camp Harris, he said the student actor minstrels in blackface were performing it, acting like they were black men working on a railroad. So there it was, the connection between the original meaning of the song, the Texas convict leasing system, blackface minstrelsy. Unfortunately, because of course, I didn't want to find this. I didn't have any strong presuppositions about or against the song. To me, it was just a song. It was certainly a weird song because like many people, to me, the song for over 10 years had just that creepy lyrics. So in one article I wrote, I said, let me give you examples. I gave 100 examples of alumni students saying these are the creepiest lyrics of any song in any school or context that I've heard. So there was something about the lyrics. And when I finally had somebody explain it to me, I don't know, maybe some years ago, somebody said, well, it was originally a joke. The reason the lyrics are weird is it was a joke. They were making fun of something a UT president used to say. And then I could understand how this joke had become this anthem. What I didn't know until I did my research was what was plainly recognized throughout the 20th century by people such as John Lang Sinclair, Lewis Johnson, or Dean Thomas U. Taylor of UT. A minstrel song became a university song. I leave it at that. That way we can switch the conversation to other speakers, but of course, naturally, I can keep adding things. Thank you.
Wonderful. Ted, before you leave, would you like to ask a question or questions?
Sure. I'm sorry that I have to leave to go teach. I guess I only have one question, and you know, I don't want to, maybe all of us can help to answer it. One of the things that I found most interesting about the final report that was placed out is that one of the headlines in terms of the summary was that there was no racial intent involved in relationship to, I guess, the creation of the song. And so I wonder if the panel has, the committee said that the song was created in the context of white supremacist, anti-black racism. And also said that the song was sung in blackface, but I was wondering why there was so much emphasis put on the intent aspect of that. I have my own sort of thinking about that, but I wonder if the panel has anything that they'd like to say about that.
I want to say, I don't have much to say about it, but I found that to be interesting that this, that now how, that somehow we're getting into intent and what were in people's minds and not into their actions. It's an interesting way to not answer the question, right? Like, well, we don't know the intent, and so therefore it wasn't racist, when it's so clear, as you suggest, that it's rooted in anti-black sentiments, anti-black male bodies.
I'll respond, and that is, I think one of the reasons that the committee addressed that question is for precisely the reason that Al became interested in it. And I'll point out, I think that what Al just said, I don't think contradicts anything that I said about just the facts of when it was performed, you know, where it comes from and all this. What Al was really focusing on is apparently the intent of the people writing the song and maybe the people singing the song afterwards. And this is where we get on disputed ground. So what was in the minds of John Sinclair? What was in the minds of Lewis Johnson when they put together this performance, when the song was written, when the song was sung? And as Dwonna, Professor Goldstone, said, we don't know the intent. You know, we can say, this is what happened, we can document this. Documenting what was in people's minds is a harder matter, especially when some of the people are, as Al pointed out, Lewis Johnson, who changed his story three or four or five times over the course of the 30 and 40 years that he talked about this. And so Al seemed to impute sort of intentional misleading. I don't think we have to go that far. I think we can say he forgot, he got his story wrong. And you know that may or may not make any difference in this. I'll just point out a couple of things. I don't dispute I certainly don't dispute anything that Al said about the prison system and convict labor and all of this stuff. I will note that there was an earlier attempt to create the song that Lewis Johnson had in mind, a song that the students could adopt as their song. And it seems to have been performed at a student talent show in 1902. And it was a takeoff on another song called Jolly Students. It was known as the Jolly Students, and it didn't catch on. Lewis Johnson wrote an editorial for the Texan. It was then the Weekly Texan that came out, I believe it was in February 1903. So this is two or three months ahead of the minstrel show, again reiterating that UT needs a song. And so it seems to have been the case in Johnson's mind that he was looking for a school song. And that seems to be what got Johnson connected with Sinclair. Sinclair was not a composer, but he was considered to be something of a poet. And so it was assumed that he would pick up a tune that somebody knew that was available. And copyright protection songs in those days was much looser than it was today, and especially since nobody knows who wrote the tune for this song. And I just add that when Sinclair wrote the lyrics, the part that we know as The Eyes of Texas, that wasn't the whole story. So there was a second verse. So the first verse, nobody even bothers. What we know is what we sing, what has commonly been sung, is the chorus. So the first verse is These Eyes of Texas, they watch above you all the day, the bright blue eyes of Texas. At night they're with you all the way, the sleepless eyes of Texas. So that's the first verse. And the second verse is, actually second and third verses, I guess, because they run together. Sing me a song of Texas and Texas myriad eyes, countless as the bright stars which fill the midnight skies. Van Dyke brown, vermilion, sepia, Prussian blue, ivory black and crimson lake, and eyes of every hue. Now, it certainly is true that this song was performed at a minstrel show, and it was in the version that it was sung, it was written to be sung at that minstrel show. But if you read those lyrics that I just read, and even if you simply listen to the lyrics of The Eyes of Texas, it certainly doesn't sound like a minstrel song. And there were other events on the program that night that had nothing to do with minstrelsy. There was a boxing match and there was a tumbling performance. And so because it was part of the minstrel show, okay, it was part of the minstrel show. But to me, that is not at all definitive evidence that it was written to mock Black people. So I'll leave it at that. And that is basically the imputation.
May I ask you a question? The first set of those lyrics sounds pretty, you're not troubled by the first lyrics that you quoted about the blue eyes and the watching and?
The sleepless eyes of Texas? No, I don't have any problem with that because, I'll add some context here. So yes, indeed, it's documented that William Prather, the president of the university, used to say that the eyes of Texas are on you. Now, I think it's important to note that he was speaking to an exclusively white student audience. So this is not white people monitoring the behavior of Black people. This is a university administration monitoring the behavior of white students. Furthermore, it seems to have been prompted by some flack that Prather was receiving from the legislature about how they heard that the spoiled students at this university were spending all of their time getting drunk. And so it seems to be connected with Prather telling the students, look, the eyes of the legislature are on you. And if you screw up, then the university is not going to get its appropriations. So it definitely is a case of somebody is watching you, but it makes more sense in the context to me that we're not watching Black convict laborers. We're people who are looking at these students and make sure they don't do stupid things that students sometimes do.
Is it possible that both of those are true, though?
It's like possible.
Okay.
Sure. Yeah, it's possible. And so I can't rule out mm-hmm. what was in some people's minds.
Mm-hmm. I'm trying to hear to understand the two positions. It seems like Al is arguing, or it's shown that the author of the song, of the lyrics, intended the song to be sung in a minstrel show as an act of mockery of Black labor. That he repeated that argument several times, that argument was made explicit in interviews and made it into the press, that there was a description of the minstrel show and of the song as the culmination of the minstrel show at the time. And so that it's incontrovertible that the song, as we know it, was sung or was created for an act of a blackface mockery of Black labor. And then we have these, no, so that is not true.
I don't know what interviews you're referring to of somebody saying that I wrote this to mock Black labor.
That the song, The Eyes of Texas, by the author Sinclair, was created, according to Sinclair himself, for this act of minstrel show, blackface minstrel show, about Black labor. That the
no.
The show.
No, he didn't say it was about Black labor. He said he wrote it because there was this minstrel show that had just been scheduled, and I and Lewis Johnson thought this would be a good opportunity to try out a new song. And for Sinclair, it may simply have been, okay, this is a one-off. Although he did write these extra lyrics, which suggests that he had more in mind than just what we know as the Eyes of Texas. And in Johnson's case, it appears to be documented that he had been looking for a song that would become a school song. So,
right, but he wasn't the author of the song. So
no, he wasn't the author of the song.
Right, so he could have been looking for a song. It doesn't really matter.
Can contradict me on this, but I don't know of any time that Sinclair said the point was to mock Black labor.
I guess I don't understand why that matters. If it was, I mean, obviously it matters, right? But the idea that, oh, it wasn't written to mock convict labor, but it was written for a minstrel show, that's right. In and of itself enough, as far as I'm concerned. And so I feel like people are splitting hairs on that issue, as if one is, well, you know, that one's bad, but it's not as bad. I don't know.
Yeah. I agree that this is splitting hairs, but I'll stop right there for now. Yeah, Al, please.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Let me chime in. Let me refer to 3 points that Bill brought up. One of them, did John Lang say that his goal was to make fun of Black people when he wrote the song? No, and or not in any evidence that I've seen. So sure. Secondly, about the lyrics that Bill brought up with, which are included in the committee's report and have been known for quite some time. For years, decades, Lewis Johnson went around North Texas showing a document that sometimes has now been called the most valuable manuscript in the state of Texas. And that document was a piece of brownish laundry paper in which John Lang Sinclair wrote draft lyrics for the song, The Eyes of Texas, in a version that apparently was not sung, at least unless one looks at Johnson's own stories. It's one of the interesting disagreements, one of the big mysteries of this. First of all, that song, whatever it is not what we know as the Eyes of Texas, because even the chorus, even what we sing, is not in that song. So if we simply say, the song that we sing, where did it come from? The undisputed answer is it came from the Blackface Minstrel Show for which it was written. But then we have this other piece of paper. And interestingly, not only did Johnson show it to some people, he mailed a couple of copies out. And one person who got wind of that, who saw these lyrics, was the author, John Lang Sinclair. So this is what he wrote to his friend, John Lomax, in 1939. He said, I don't like to close this cheerful letter on a sour note, but I feel like getting out an injunction against Lewis Johnson if he is passing out that drivel as mine. I got a copy from Ed Nunnally a couple of years ago, and what I told him was plenty. I never heard of it before, and I'm sure I never quite was such a fool as to write anything like that. I would repudiate and class it as a fake, even if confronted with it in my own writing. Yours, John Lang Sinclair. So the author himself thought that. Now, let's suppose, well, maybe John Lang was confused. And, you know, so then we'd have to bring in a handwriting analyst to actually check, did John Lang write this contrary to his own explanation? Or is this just a cheap, lousy, lazy forgery by Johnson, which acquired pseudo-religious mythological status in the imagination of UT students looking for their history? Let's leave that as point number two. And then point number three that I meant to say is, let me think, what was it? About the origins of the song. Let me think, maybe it'll come back to me. Yeah, I'll move on. You guys can comment. It'll come back to me in a moment.
Well, this is striking. What I understand you to say, Al, is that these document that is being presented as exculpatory of the intent of the original intent of the Eyes of Texas was actually a forgery. It might have been a creation of Johnson. Sinclair, the author himself, repeatedly argued that the song was for a minstrel show, blackface, whose intention was to mock blacks.
I just have to stop you.
Okay,
Jorge, you're.
And I am trying to understand what
I know.
Al is
I know,
saying.
But let's just get clear that, and as Al noted, John Sinclair never said my purpose in writing this song was to mock blacks. Now you're saying that because it was performed at a minstrel show, therefore we can conclude that it was written to mock blacks. It's a different statement. And it may
I understand that
much,
the description,
but it is a different statement.
The description of the show in 1903 says the description of the show at the time. Says that it was about mockery of blacks. Am I wrong, Al?
Read me where it says that we're going to hold this show to mock blacks.
No. The description in the press.
And isn't that the purpose of a minstrel show?
I disagree there.
That is one of the purposes of a minstrel show.
The purpose of a minstrel show is entertainment. Now, it is true that historically, black people, in fact, in particular, caricatures of black people, mm-hmm. were often the butts of jokes at minstrel shows. But I would suggest that they're more than that, because how does one explain the very many numbers of black performers who took part in minstrel shows?
Sometimes that's the only way they could make money. I mean, I think that to say that black people were there and so therefore it must not have meant that that's disingenuous.
We might disagree. It's not disingenuous. What I would say is though, that at any given time, people choose among the options available to them.
Mm-hmm.
And so, well-known composers, Rosamund Johnson, you wrote My Castle on the Nile, which was the feature song at that minstrel show in 1903. And he didn't have to write that song. He didn't have to write that song for that purpose, but he did. And if you look at the songs that were on the bill that night, there are some that are clearly minstrel songs and there are others that are clearly not minstrel songs. By this time, minstrel shows were variety shows. And as I mentioned earlier, there was a boxing match, there was a tumbling act, there were various other things as well. So it is true that this song was sung in blackface, but all the songs that evening were sung in blackface. And by the way, I would agree with you, Dwonna, that we're splitting hairs here, because I think actually the intent of the song is not all that important, because people are gonna draw their conclusions from that. I'd like to sort of move on and see if we can go beyond this, because we can talk forever about the intent, and never get any closer to what was in the heads of the people who were involved.
I think the other thing too, and you've hit on this a little bit, is we really can't get into the intent, but we can later on when Texas Cowboys are singing this, they are doing minstrels too.
Okay, I will add something about that on since you raised the issue. So when the Texas Cowboys sang the Eyes of Texas as their minstrel shows, this was at a time when the university had adopted the Eyes of Texas. And so university commencement, the graduation ceremonies of the history department would close with the Eyes of Texas. Pretty much every function of the University of Texas closed with the singing of the Eyes of Texas. And it appears that that's the way it was performed at the Texas Cowboys. Now, one could argue that, all right, they shouldn't have been having these minstrel shows, which were odious, but the Eyes of Texas was sung as a coda to this university event. So whether that makes any difference to the people who are considering this is up to them. But I think it's important to know that they were not necessarily extending the minstrel life, if any, of this song. This was a function of the University of Texas, and everything at the University of Texas concluded with the Eyes of Texas.
Let me interject.
Yeah.
I have three points, one of them to this question about minstrel shows by the Cowboy Minstrels or the Cowboys organization into the 1960s. In disagreement with what Dr. Brands has said, I think this is an extension of the minstrel tradition. As I showed in one of my articles, this song was sang not only in 1903 by minstrels, but continued to be sung by decades before the song became an official university song. So this song was sung by blackface UT minstrels when UT faculty committee in 1920 banned the song because they thought it was a disgrace. So this song was a blackface minstrel song of this university before it became the university's anthem. That's point number one. Point number two, when Professor Brands brings up other songs that were sang at the 1903 show, one has to actually look at the lyrics of the songs, because one of the songs he mentions, My Castle on the Nile, is a satirical song making fun of Black people. And the lyrics say, there ain't no use in trying to rise up in their social scale, because having failed to advance socially, the Black person sings about having to return to Africa, and it says, having found out that I come down from old Chief Bungabu, therefore he would live in his castle on the Nile with a monkey for my valet and a baboon butler at my due. So this is a super racist, highly inappropriate song. Whoever composed it—
But the point is,
this is a song making fun of the difficult situation of Black people who did not succeed in the US. And therefore it was funny for white Americans to imagine that the Black man is going back to the jungle to be served by his baboon butler. So that's one thing. And now my third point, and I'll shut up after this. Bill brought up a song that ostensibly, allegedly, Lewis Johnson, and Lewis Johnson alone, says was an attempt by John Sinclair to create a university song, an attempt that sort of failed, which led to the creation of the Eyes of Texas. So Lewis Johnson went around saying, as does UT's committee report, that song, Jolly Students of the Varsity, was created first. What I found in my research is that song was not created first. It was created second. And the reason why it's quite obvious that it was not created first is because the song on which it was based, which is a song by a composer called Harry Zickel, was not published until October of 1903. So it couldn't have been performed in spring of 1903 because the song on which it is based did not exist. So it's another example of Lewis Johnson confounding the stories in numerous ways. I mean, I've written a lot about what he said about Jolly Students, and point by point, what he said was nonsense and false. For example, the UT report says that song premiered at a variety show. It didn't, it premiered at a minstrel show. it didn't premiere in 1902, it premiered in November of 1903. So, you know, some of these things are just chronological, but one has to get them right. And unfortunately, as I've said, Lewis Johnson is just not an authority on any of this because the things he said were demonstrably inaccurate.
I have a question for you, Al. You, in one of your articles, you demonstrate, you go into the descriptions in newspapers at the time and student correspondence of the event of the inauguration of the song of the minstrel show, blackface, etc. And if I remember correctly, your description of that evening is that even the witnesses of the evening event were appalled by the nature of many of the things that went on in the show. Is that true? I mean, what was the historical actors themselves during the show, as described by the press and by the letters, et cetera, are saying about the context in which that performance happened?
No, I think there's one line in which that performance is described, among other statements, by saying very few people were offended, because there are these comedians, these end men who pranced around and did funny skits. And the point is, how offensive is it? So I think there's a statement that says very few people were offended, but that doesn't speak directly to the Eyes of Texas song. And I personally don't think that at the moment, the people who were there, the white audience, students, the governor, the president of the university, thought the song was offensive. I think they thought it was all good fun. And, you know, obviously now we think it's offensive. We would not dream of, let's all replicate, let's commemorate the first singing of the Eyes of Texas song to sing it the way it was sung back then. So to us, it would clearly be inappropriate to have black men on a work gang working on the railroad while someone sings, you know, "You Cannot Get Away," etc. You know, we would not sing that, but at the moment it was just great fun. And of course, as Bill or others and the report point out, there's another conscious level at which the theater goer is enjoying the event, is that the event is making fun of the UT president. And this is one of the few kinds of incidents back then when people were pretty well dressed most of the times and pretty well, I don't know, they were expected to be, you know, full-fledged adults at the University of Texas. And a good chance to blow off steam was to put on a minstrel show. And I'll leave it at that.
I want to say one thing, and that is, if I read Al's, I think the latest one correctly, this indication that the people who sang the song were playing as though they were on a railroad crew, I believe that comes from a recollection many years after the fact. There's nothing in the contemporary reviews, and there was a review in the Texan, the Weekly Texan, and the Austin Statesman that said nothing about that. And it said nothing about anybody taking any offense. And it was clear from the context that if anybody had been taking offense, they wouldn't have not have been taking offense that somehow this slighted black people. It would have been that the university president felt slighted by the joke that was being made at his expense.
Okay. As I said, I can look for it now. What is the phrase that says something about very few people were offended? I think that just speaks to the comedy of the situation and the jokes. As for the first point, Bill, can you clarify, what was your first point again?
That the testimony or the evidence that says that the singers were pretending to be in a chain gang or working on the railroad. That comes from much after the fact, because there's no indication on the program or in the reviews that they did anything like that.
Most of the events that happened on that event of 1903 were reviewed with a single line or half a line, not with descriptions of exactly what was the sequence of things that happened. But as with any other events, by looking at participant testimonies, this was Henry Camp Harris, a performer who sang both before and after The Eyes of Texas song was sung. It was published in a major newspaper in Texas. Nobody wrote to deny and reply and say, this is not what happened. He's trying to make it seem, it was just, you know, something that's, some agreement to Bill, certainly if there were some evidence to contradict this claim by Henry Camp Harris, then I would change my belief that that is what happened. But I build my arguments, my historical accounts on the basis of what there is, not on the basis of what might exist to contradict it, which I haven't found.
Well, but needless to say, nobody's going to contradict something that didn't happen. Because, and they wouldn't know that somebody is going to remember it this other way decades later. So you wouldn't expect that somebody writing review the day after is going to say, no, it really wasn't. They didn't pretend they were on a chain gang. But there's no mention. And those reviews, they filled a full newspaper column.
Bill.
But
sometimes newspaper reports are wrong, and something that someone writes 10 or 20 years later, such as the list of the quartet singers in one of the newspapers, was wrong, and it's verifiably wrong.
I know, and it doesn't even, the list of the singers doesn't even match the program, so the reporting wasn't very good. I'll grant that. And as much as I respect the Daily Text and the students who work there now, these are students putting out a newspaper, so yes, I'll grant that part of it.
Oh, hold on. Can I make a point? So someone in the comment, John Grashwich, I hope I've pronounced his last name correctly, said, a discussion about the forces trying to change the song in place is the only way to change anything. If the narrative can be kept focused on the historical context only relating to the origin and not the meaning and implications of its continued use, nothing about the current situation will evolve. So I'm kind of curious it seems like we're focusing so much on intent and things that we can't really understand. And so I'm wondering how focusing on that keeps the discussion on that, which can't be changed, and not on what this song means in today's society and how it makes Black students, Brown students feel, how it makes Black football players feel to sing this. That seems to get missed in this conversation is how does it feel today to be a student of color at the University of Texas while so many people think that the song is so great and we're arguing about facts that some of which can't be proven. Although I think that's my question.
I would be delighted to take the conversation in that direction because I think that'd be much more productive.
Sure. Let me reply to that with a couple of thoughts. As has been pointed out, for example, by law professor Gary Bledsoe, of course, we have to look at not only the intent, but the impact. And it's very common in white America to say, you know, I wasn't trying to hurt anyone. We were just trying to have fun. When we were throwing water balloons at students who happened to be Black and the water happened to have some bleach, all kinds of awful things have happened at this university in which people were just trying to have fun. The minstrel shows were one of them. And we had slave auctions at UT from say 1950 until at least 1970. A tradition that I saw growing up in Puerto Rico, I went for 3 years to a school, primarily English school, and you know the slave auction day would happen. Now these kids who were the children of rich white people, where I learned to speak English, would bid money on. You know, now it's not done. Now in Puerto Rico, probably slave auctions are not done, but they were great fun at UT for you know at least a couple of decades. So the impact of these things, you know, when we start digging at this history that many people would rather not know and would rather forget. Many students have written, have complained, have petitioned. Last year, more than 19,000 people signed a petition begging UT to acknowledge the racist roots of the Eyes of Texas. I don't think the university has yet done that. I don't know if Jay Hartzell personally can do that, but he should. He should. He should acknowledge the connection to Black convict leasing, the connection to General Lee, the main phrase and title of the song are based on words by and about General Lee in the Civil War in 1864, in the Battle of the Wilderness in Virginia on May 6th. And this is uncontested. Since I published, this is uncontested, nobody. Jay Hartzell, as speaker for the university, because neither I nor Bill nor Jorge speak for the universities, a couple of people do, the public communications people. I don't know if they will ever get around to meeting the multiple great recommendations of the UT History Committee to create an exhibit at the DKR Stadium about the song, to teach courses about the song, to create another exhibit at another building, to numerous of these things. Will they actually happen? I frankly think they won't happen ever since I came out with my articles. But speaking to the impact, students have complained that it is insulting, demeaning, degrading, humiliating, and an embarrassment to UT to have to sit through a song or listen to a song that was first performed at a blackface minstrel show. And these are students who, for the most part, are not discussing intent, are not discussing whether John Lang Sinclair wrote it for the minstrel show or it happened to be sung there. They've said that this devalues their humanity. They've ranged from football athletes who have made public pronouncements and have then said in social media that they were threatened, by UT administrators, that they had to stand for the song or they would never get a job in the state of Texas again. And it worked. They shut up. Multiple of them came out and said what happened, and they were successfully shut up and silenced. Tour guides at UT were protesting for months, saying we will not work until a song is removed. People have written articles in the Daily Texan complaining that the Tower Bell plays the song, complaining recently that the graduation ring says the eyes of Texas are upon you. So that complaining that the song was played at orientation. So it's very unusual nationwide to have one song in any university that generates this much dissatisfaction, especially amongst the Black students in a university. I think UT should do what Ole Miss did, the University of Mississippi. They took Dixie, which was a song they sang. I wish I weren't was in Dixie. They sang it happily at football games for a long time, and then they retired it. I think in 2006 or 2016, they got rid of it. I know it's difficult for Jay because, you know, in some sense, apparently he's been threatened too by donors who want to take away their money. But guess what? UT is the most extraordinarily rich public school that I've ever imagined. So, you know, at what point can we stop ignoring the advice of financial consultants who always say, don't touch your billions, instead beg for more? It's just ridiculous that we have to be beholden to people who are just angry because some Black athletes don't want to sing a song. If someone doesn't want to sing a song, they should be perfectly welcome, respected to not sing it, or to not attend an event in which it's being sung. Anyhow, I think I've gone on too much, but as you can see, I've given a thumbnail sketch. I wrote an article titled 100 Problems in the Eyes of Texas, which I enumerate, and people have been complaining about this song for many years. Many white alumni can just shrug it off and enjoy it and sing it with their hook'em horns high in the air because it doesn't mean any of this to them. And that's why I say forgetting is an essential part. It never meant any of that to them. Therefore, we're the ones who are wrong because we're nitpicking and navel gazing at lint and old stuff that nobody should think about. That's the way they see it. But I tell you, I changed my mind. I didn't have a strong opinion a year ago when I first heard of the students' comments. And you know, it's really not that hard to do if we when we go through these kinds of concerns.
I'd like to share my reaction when Jay Hartzell asked me to join the committee. My first response was yes. I work at UT. I never say no to somebody asking me to be on a committee. It's part of my job. But I also pointed out, and more specifically to Rich Reddick, the head of the committee, I said that, you know, the problem is not the eyes of Texas. The problem is the history of the University of Texas, because it was founded in the era of Jim Crow segregation, of institutionalized white supremacy. And anything that comes out of that era is going to have reflections of that. And we can be debating the eyes of Texas, And it comes out of that era, and it is going to be tainted by coming out of that era. But there are any number of other things. And so, for example, the University of Texas was racially segregated until the 1950s. And so if we object to The Eyes of Texas, which was sung at a minstrel show in 1903, should we not be objecting at the fact that UT was segregated for another half century? Should we object to the fact that nearly every building on the core of the campus was built by Jim Crow labor? So at what point do we say history is there? We can't change it, but we can learn from it, and we can demonstrate that we no longer do things that we've come to consider objectionable.
But we are still doing those things, right? Like, I think continuing to sing the song, continuing to keep the names on these buildings is, I, you know, there's this idea that, well, that happened in the past and how far back can we go? I think you go back as far back as you need to go, right? Like, I think that just because something happened in the past, we don't know the intent and, you know, it's that idea of what does it mean today? All of this feels performative in terms of, well, we did this committee and the song didn't have this and on all this without really having a meaningful discussion about what does it mean to be a Black student at the University of Texas in 2021 when people want to defend this and say things like, well, how far back do we go? I think you go back as far as you need to go. And if it means it's not about erasing the history, it's acknowledging and moving and trying to repair the history. There seems to be nothing said about how do we repair the history. All we're saying is, well, let's just keep the song. It's not that bad. Yes, it has problems, but what else? What are we doing to repair? And it seems like not very much.
My response to that is you can't repair history. History is done. We can't go back and change things that happened in 1903. We can concentrate on issues that we consider should be addressed today.
But what are we doing?
This is exactly my
point. I think defending the song is one way to maintain these systems, to defend the song as well. There are other things we need to move on. But what is the University of Texas doing?
Well, one of the things I would say is we're wasting a lot of our time talking about this song.
Well, then presumably just get rid of it. We move on. But then
what's the next thing we get rid of? Is there some sort of end point of this agenda? I mean, you say until we're done, but we're never done because every institution has a past. Every individual has a past. And if we focus, I think, too much on the past, then we lose sight of the things that we can do today. I want to just move this slightly to a philosophical realm. And that is the question, to how much does the present owe to the past, including the parts of the past that we now find problematic, that make us uncomfortable? I would just put this out. So it's possible to imagine that we would feel better if the University of Texas had never been segregated. Okay? And presumably that would be better, except that if people who were thinking about the University of Texas had insisted on an integrated University of Texas, there never would have been a University of Texas, because there was a time in American history where universities were being created. And that was a time when the South and Texas was segregated. So there was no chance of saying at the beginning, okay, this is going to be an integrated university. Now, it's actually a mark of progressivism that was integrated by sex. So women have attended UT from the very beginning, unlike very many places, including every Ivy League school. But to imagine that there was an alternative history, an alternative history of the University of Texas that did not include things like minstrel shows, is a vain effort. And so I think we'd say, okay, this is the song that was sung then. It has been, and it was not sung by any Black people, at least not as part of the UT community until the 1950s. But we are now 60 years past the 1950s, and Black people, brown people, Asian people have been singing The Eyes of Texas for the last 50 years. Do they get any ownership in this? And how about there are 550,000 UT alums, and the great majority of them, when they were singing this song, had no idea that it had ever occurred to anybody that this was racist. Do they get a vote in this. And do you want to ask the question, so why not just get rid of this? And the answer is because it means a lot to a lot of people. And
well, so do the menstrual shows, but we don't do those anymore.
Well, exactly. Because time came when a great majority of people, this is important, decided the menstrual shows were a really bad thing to keep doing. And at the moment, if you were to take a vote, now, you know, we can decide whether democracy is the way to answer this one. But at the moment, I'm pretty sure that a great majority of UT alums would say, keep the eyes of Texas.
Well, majority of them are going to be white too. So
well, exactly. That's right. But do they not get a vote? And so, I mean, I understand that certain people don't like it and that, you know, they're entitled to their opinion. I think white people are entitled to their opinion
right.
too. I'm not saying that democracy is the answer to all these issues.
But it always seems like the only opinion that matters are the white alumni and those with money. Because if we did do this vote, and when you talk about the 550,000 alumni, there was a time when Black people weren't allowed to go to school here, as you pointed out. So sure. that's just okay. not,
okay.
I mean, that's just not fair.
I don't know if any of you watched the video that was part of the report showing Barbara Smith Conrad proudly singing The Eyes of Texas at commencement in 2001, a Black woman who was denied the opportunity. She was one of the first Black people to integrate UT, and she was denied a role, a wonderful opera singer, denied a role because she was playing opposite a Black male lead. And she was understandably very upset about this, but she made her peace over time with the University of Texas at the point that she led the university in singing The Eyes of Texas at commencement. Now, I'm not going to say that her example is an example for everybody else, but it is another option. Instead of just saying, I don't like the origins of this, let's get rid of it, can we move past it without denying its roots?
And I get your point, Bill. I mean, yeah. it's a good point. I understand your point. I mean, we cannot continue kind of pruning out everything that we don't like from the past. But the case of the opera singer that you mentioned, had she known all we know now about the origins of the song and the relationship to forced labor, et cetera, the context in which it emerged, et cetera, had she known that, she probably would have not sung the song. So with the knowledge we have about the past, there are things that are worth pruning, that are worth editing out. Why wouldn't this song be one of the things that are worth eliminating and creating something else? I'm not saying that we have to change the name of every pavilion and every building on campus, although there are a few that should be changed, like Painter. But in the case of the song, given the context and information we have, and given the reaction that it produces in many students, Black, white, Hispanics, et cetera, and not only students, but faculty and staff, it should be reconsidered. It should be, given the opposition, it should be reconsidered. These are the things that need to be changed, as many things have changed. I don't know what you think, Alberto.
I want to just say real quickly that the fact that Barbara Conrad sang that song in 2001 doesn't mean it's okay. That you, one Black woman singing it, two Black women, however many you want, doesn't mean that the song is okay and that Black people approve of it. And I don't know if that was the point you're trying to make, but that's how I heard it, that somehow because she sang it, that we're no longer allowed to interrogate its racism anymore. Like you said, Jorge, that I don't know that she knew the origins of the song in 2001. And had she known, I don't know if she would have.
Let me say something about change. We have a motto, what starts here changes the world, but there are countless many white alumni who don't want change inside UT. The world can change, people can do anything, but don't change things at UT because it's my UT. And they say, if you don't like it, get the hell out. And they tell Hartzell, why don't you please tell those Black students or Black athletes that they should go to a different university if they don't like my school song? So the song has been used not long ago, but in the present as an oppressive tool for discrimination and marginalization, whether it is football athletes who were told to shut up where they would never get a job in the state of Texas, or whether it is students who don't want to play the song in the school band and therefore have to be bribed with scholarships and all kinds of weird stuff. Have, you know, the amount of embarrassing, troubling, and disturbing things that have happened because of the song is just too much. So as Professor Goldstone rightly explains in her book, UT has been engaged in this denial of its racist past. And then they say, well, look, let's have a conversation. Let's have a difficult dialogue, but we won't change anything.
Uh-huh.
The dialogue will be difficult for you because you will hear that we're listening to you, but we're not going to change anything. Because,
like you said,
majority, this is just,
you don't like it, get out.
It's just infantile. I mean, the university is a research institution, should take uh-huh. the duty seriously of making the publication that the UT's committee said should happen, a scholarly publication saying the facts about the song, and own up to this. And if they did that, they would educate their alumni, who would come to understand why many Black people and people of color, including myself, feel uncomfortable with this song. It's not rocket science. If the song only had one connection that we could say, oh, the song is based on a racist Levy song and leave it at that, that would be pretty bad. But the fact that it's got four or more, the creepy stalker surveillance lyrics, the connection to General Lee and the Civil War, the performance in the Blackface Minstrel Show, that it was written for the Blackface Minstrel Show, that it was recognized as offensive by faculty in 1920 who didn't want UT band members playing that song, that it was sung by Blackface cowboy minstrels for decades. You know, it goes to show that one of the problems at this university is that we have a traditionally insensitive culture, which is again what Professor Goldstone brings out in her book. In other words, do we really need to get to 51% vote to change this? Of course not. And my problem with that democratic portrayal is most of the things in this university are not done by democracy. So then democracy gets suggested as a way to change something that, say, Jay Hartzell doesn't want to change, and mainly Jay Hartzell alone. I'll tell you, I've been talking about this song, The Eyes of Texas, for months. I haven't had a single professor write me an email saying, I like the song and I want to keep the song. Nobody. Why is that? So this is what I'm getting at. What I'm getting at is, yes, in some sense, there is white supremacy at UT. It goes to fill, you know, different forms and different shapes. And one of the shapes in which it manifests itself is not in the origins of the song, but is in the inability to just take the feedback from Black people, whether they are Black professors or op-ed writers or students or football, saying, look, let's please not sing this song, or give me the right to not sing it, or give me the right not to stand for it. Why? Who cares about a song? Why don't we care about what we should really care about? People who write an email saying we should look at a more important thing like enrollments at UT. UT can't pass 5 or 6% threshold of Black enrollments for reasons that I am sadly aware of, which is that we have something called a holistic method, which always depresses the enrollments that instead we could be getting by automatic admissions alone or by nearly any method used by any university in the state of Texas. For admissions. So we could look at that and then not talk about the song. So why do we talk about the song? Because the song is a symbol, mm-hmm. and symbols have a certain power. And sometimes the power is, it's not just about a memory that wants to be forgotten. It's about who gets to make decisions and who gets to say, you shut up while we play our song. And if you don't like it, you can go to a different university. That is the problem with UT. That's the problem. We have to say, look, what they did in Mississippi was correct. You know what? We want an open and inclusive place. We understand that this song makes some people uncomfortable, not the majority of the football fans, but we're going to change it because we want to have diversity, equity as inclusion as reality, not as words, because now UT has diversity, equity as inclusion as stickers that we can put on everything. Just as a reality. And I think it's doable for people who are watching. I think this will happen. It's just a matter of time. I don't know if it's going to be in 6 months or in 8 years, but I think, frankly, it's inevitable. When we all saw the statue of General Lee being removed from a park in Virginia a couple of months ago, a huge statue, you know, this is, even if you don't like change and you wanted Hutt's Hamburgers to remain where it was and Madam Mam's to remain where it was and countless many businesses, many of us don't like change. Guess what? Change is coming. And it's coming to UT. It's sad that, you know, we're not pioneers at change, but I think it's coming.
All right. Professor Goldstone, any other thoughts on how to, what are the issues with enrollment? Why enrollment remains so, of African-Americans and Hispanics, by the way, given the statistics in the state. Why they remain so low? Well, might have to do with the symbolism as well. I mean, people, African-Americans do not feel welcome in an institution that seems has an anthem that is really perverse. From any perspective you see it, it's perverse, it's grotesque, if you ask me. So how we think about the present, not about the past, and enact change that makes these institution a welcoming space for African Americans and majorities, people of color.
You know, I'm beginning to think that the University of Texas actually does not want what it says it wants, and I think the fight over keeping this song is simply a metaphor for this idea that we'll give you lip service, we'll set up these committees, but we're not going to really do the hard work of making this a welcoming campus. I've had a few students, few Black students who transferred from UT and just said, I didn't feel like I was welcome there. And when I pressed them, you know, why did you leave? They said, it just never felt like it was a place for Black students. And I think even if we look at, someone mentioned the emails to the Texas Tribune that some of these alumni sent, at the end of the day, it's about the money. And the University of Texas would rather align itself with the people who have the money than with making sure they do whatever is necessary. And I do think a lot of this is symbolism, that whether the song goes away, is it going to make the campus more welcoming for Black students? No. You know, but they're symbols, and symbols are powerful. And until the University of Texas does the work, nothing is going to change. And as long as they continue to defend this song, nothing is going to change. And they're going to stay at 4, 5, 6% and be happy if they ever make it to double digits. I don't think that'll ever happen.
Let me chime in on this regard. There's a nice myth going around amongst people who don't see a problem at UT. They say, well, the Black students don't come in because they're not smart enough. We wish they could meet the threshold. There are countless many super smart Black students in other universities in Texas that chose not to come here, either because there was no good financial aid, financial help offer, or because they had heard this recurring statement, which is UT is racist. I mean, this thing. If you have some Black Austin friends, you will heal this boy. You know, everybody knows UT is racist. My dentist is Black, and she told me that her daughter, who had excellent grades, wouldn't apply to UT because UT is racist. And she said it's so sad that she wouldn't even, this is the power of that image. But just to clarify the myth to people who don't understand that it is a myth, 13% of all college students in Texas are Black. 13%, that is, they exceed their percentage of the population, which might be somewhere around 12.7. So maybe it's 13.4. And here we struggle to get 5. Sometimes we get nearly 6. This is absurd. So this is, I mean, the university just has to fix this. And who's the university? It's Jay Hartzell. Jay Hartzell. One guy simply has to decide, you know what? I'm president, I'm going to fix admissions at UT so that we let Black students in. But so long as you don't want to do that because you don't think about it, people don't think about it, then you can't do it. But you have to be able to say, in our culture, we have a problem here. We have a problem here. And what are these problems? It's not that we need another task force or committee or commission or report or, you know, diversity officers or any of the many things that we can do as window dressing, it's that we need to fix inclusion. You know, 138 years, every president has been a white person. 138 years, every provost and executive vice president has been a white person. Deans of liberal art, deans of engineering, you know, when do we get diversity here? Why is it so difficult here? And these are all structural problems. They're cultural problems. They don't write them down about, you know, they don't write it down as a goal, but somehow it happens again and again and again. And then when something like the Eyes of Texas comes along, it becomes a symbol for that. It becomes a touchstone. Ah, well, you know, their song also. It's not that their song has racist roots, it's that their song also has this racist dimension, has these other realities that they've experienced again and again. And, you know, I became aware of this years ago. I suddenly realized I've got about 100 students per semester. Why is it that only one of them is Black? One. How could that be? Every semester I've got one or none. Why is that? And you know, the people thought, well, there's obviously something wrong with you. There's five, you know, if you want to, you know, like I've got to teach a course titled African-American Students to Get Black Students because Black students only care about Black topics. It's insane that people would think that. But I look forward to conversations like this one. I think all of this these problems are easy and solvable. All they take is will. Because as I said, this has nothing to do with democracy. It has nothing to do with getting a majority. It simply has to do with leadership. And we have to get to a point where the people who are administrators become actual leaders rather than people who need to hire consultants from McKinsey, Accenture, et cetera. We have millions of people, to business people, to tell us what to do, because anyone who's been here long enough knows that there are problems and has proposals for solutions. Jorge, is there anything from the questions in the chat that maybe you want us to bring up before we start thinking about
it? There are hundreds of comments it's difficult to keep up with the Q&A and the comments, but there's a lot of support for many of the things that are said, but no specific questions that I can identify.
Anybody, you can add questions now. We still have a few minutes. That way, it's
for instance, we have one that says, based on the expertise represented here, Dr. Goldstone is best positioned to answer my question. Why do we seem to struggle to move from a focus on origin stories and intent to the present day experiences of performing and listening to the song? Why is this not the emphasis of UT research and reports? How can we support our students in navigating our institution's decisions not to act on the song? Well, we kind of already tackled that one, but Professor Goldstone.
Yeah, no, I think we definitely already tackled that, but I also think going back to the past is a way not to deal with today. I think it's, you know, as Al said, there's this idea I don't know how you change that. And the continued defense of the song just tells Black students, you're not welcome here. And I don't think I'm not this naive that I think getting rid of the song somehow will make UT less racist. I think that the digging in of the heels and the maintaining of the song just tells Black students what UT really thinks about them.
I'll add something to that, which is that part of UT's history has been that administrators have been reluctant to change things when Black students were finally allowed by the intervention of the Supreme Court to enroll at this university. They started complaining about the Blackface minstrel shows, and the administrators did nothing to stop them. Not only did the administrators not stop them, but they performed, like say Dean Arno Nowotny would be in these Blackface minstrel shows. The first minstrel show organized at UT, 1903, which is the song, the show in which the Eyes of Texas was born, that minstrel show was organized officially by UT's athletics director. Think about that. Let that sink in. The athletics director wanted money for a team, for a track team. So they did a blackface minstrel show. So there's a lot of role modeling going on here about administrators themselves leading the way and saying, well, you know, let's just leave things as they are, rather than listening to students. As, for example, I'm listening to them. I wouldn't have gotten into it if I hadn't seen so many students complaining about the song and heard about some of the things that, say, Ted Gordon's research had illuminated about the origins of the song. When I read UT's committee report, and I found that the author of the song himself admitted that he probably looked grotesque when he was wearing blackface paint, singing the song on the first day that the song was sung, I thought that's enough. I thought that, you know, not only was it performed for the black at the show, but it was blackface and the guy himself. And then someone said that his clothing looked Negroesque, a professor of English literature, Robert Edgar Law, said that, and John Sinclair felt offended or disappointed or hurt. He said, I feel hurt that they said my clothing looked Negroesque because it was just my clothing. It's just too unfortunate, you know, to agree with what Bill is saying. We don't want to erase the history. We don't want to bury it. I think there should be displays about the eyes of Texas, courses, discussions. I don't even think that people shouldn't be allowed to sing it. If people want to sing something, they can sing whatever they want, as far as I care. I just don't think it should be the official university song, because the one thing a university song should do, if anything, is create some unity. And this is not a song that creates that unity. So here we are. And I think, you know, it could come from the students. I've told some students, you shouldn't wait for Jay Hartzell to tell you to write a song. Just write a song, create something. And that can be the process by which change comes about. Because oftentimes the change is not going to come from the top. That's why people get promoted, because they maintain the status quo and because they don't rock the boat. And, you know, rock the boat, you're not going to get those perks and titles and awards that are always, it's for professors. Those of you who are professors, listen, to me, it's an infinite row of carrots that is ever waiting for anyone to just keep their mouth shut. Keep your mouth shut. You'll get everything from a professorship to raises, to committees. You'll get all kinds of things. And then you rock the boat, you're going to be penalized. It's absurd that we should have that in our culture and that people should be afraid of someone like Jay. Jay's just another guy. He's trying to do his job. He has good intentions. I'm not afraid of him. But it is, you know, countless many people I know at UT are afraid because, well, if I say something, I'd get in trouble with the president. And it's not the culture that we should be having at a university.
All right. Well,
Jorge,
yes.
Could I add an endorsement of Al's recommendation about having students get together and write a new song? And I think there would be a wonderful poetic and historic symmetry to all of this, because, of course, the Eyes of Texas originated as a student effort. It wasn't created by any administration. So if somebody can write a better song, more power to them.
Yeah, I think my 9-year-old could write a better song, definitely, given the context. but yeah, I support that one wholeheartedly. All right. Well, it's 1:30. I really appreciate the honesty, the clarity, the force brought by everyone here. And I'm thankful for all participants and also for the audience that kept on commenting on your performance throughout the hour and a half we had here. And it was difficult to keep up with the conversation and the Q&A at once, and also the chat. But I really appreciate it. This is going to be online for those of you who couldn't make it. Let's hope that things do change and the song soon disappears from our vocabulary, as the anthem of the university. Thank you very much, and I'll see you next week for those of you who are part of our calendar and follow our weekly events. Well, thank you.